Amen. What a joy that was when the light came. People in darkness saw a great light. In fact, that's spoken in the book of Isaiah. And if you have any Bibles, you want to turn there to Isaiah chapter 7. We'll look at the verse this morning. Because there was an expectation throughout the centuries of Israel that there would come one, a king would come, a Messiah would come. Messiah means anointed one. They would think of that as a king, some of royalty would come, who would deliver the people. Now, they've had experiences of that. But throughout Israel's history, their ancient writings, throughout the Old Testament, there was an expectation of a human deliverer who would come for Israel. For instance, in hundreds of these verses, by the way, I'm just sharing a few of them. Genesis 3:15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed, it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise its heel. Expectation that one would come who would take care of Satan and all his evil. Genesis 49:10, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, and unto him shall be the gathering of the people. Now, we didn't know what those words meant. They didn't know what it meant at the time, but looking back, we realize what they were speaking about. They were speaking about someone who would come someday. Psalm 118, the stone which the builders rejected had become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Isaiah 11:1, there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. A branch shall grow out of his roots. Those prophecies, those predictions, those expectations were very specific. Somehow this king, this deliverer would come forth from David. They knew that because of the promise to David. David would always have a ruler upon the throne. So they look forward to that expectation. Malachi 3:1, behold, I will send my messenger. He shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord, whom ye seek, shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant, whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. There was always an expectation of the ancient Hebrews that there would come someone who would set them free and would deliver them. They didn't realize he would be an eternal deliverer. But the hopes of people were not just in the Old Testament. The Old Testament ones, the former heroes, you know, Moses, Samuel, David. Where David was a great deliverer, you might say. Fought the giant, Daniel. And they look back at these folks, they're very proud of them. Even some of the intertestamental people, like Judas Maccabees, we don't know much about, but if you study the period between the Old and New Testaments, you'll find there were still Jewish people who were heroes for these Jewish folks. The season that we're in, we'll soon be in, is called the season of lights. The Jewish people celebrate, and that had to do with Judas Maccabees and his deliverance from the Greeks in that time. But the anticipation was always there that another would come someday and that they would look forward to that coming, because every Jewish girl throughout the history of Israel looked forward to maybe she could be the mother of this Messiah, this deliverer. And every Jewish boy would hope that maybe he could grow up to somehow deliver Israel, to fulfill some of those ancient prophecies. And in an obscure little text here in the book of Isaiah is a verse, a passage, written 700 years before Jesus came. And this verse clearly points out that a Savior would come to Bethlehem. Now, we didn't use those words, but we know, looking back, exactly what he was saying. Look now in Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Again, obscure, tiny little verse. We wouldn't think anything of it if you read it at the time. Because actually, King Ahaz, this cruel and really foolish ruler of Judah. Remember, Judah and Israel, the two nations, were separated this time. In fact, Israel, the north, was attacking Judah all the time. And King Ahaz, who was this leader, was on a collision course with God's judgment. There was extreme wickedness in the king of Judah. And you think, well, the Judah was a good side, because they stayed another 70 years. No, they were just as wicked. He burned his own children. He threw them into the fire in worship of sacrifice to Moloch. Can you imagine such a thing? It's like taking a child and your own children and slaying them. Ahaz was captured once by King Pekah and Rezin, the king, Syria's king, who combined, by the way. And while he was in Damascus in bondage, he worshipped and fell down and worshipped the foreign gods that they were worshipping. Israel and Syria were set to attack Judah and King Ahaz in this passage. That's the context of what's going on here. These two folks, by the way, let me make it clear, Syria is not the same as Assyria. At this time, Assyrian Empire, far to the north, this huge empire, was getting ready to come down and take every one of these peoples away. And they did eventually, within about 35 years. They were ready to attack. Syria is just north of Israel. Syria, Damascus, those cities of that region. They were sort of less buddies with the Israel groups here. And they're both ganging up, Israel, King Pekah of Israel, Rezin of Syria, were getting ready to attack against Judah and King Ahaz. And the Assyrian kings, by the way, these great rulers of this great empire that was soon to come down, included Tiglath-Pileser III. He would soon die, and his son Shalmaneser V would take over as king, then Sargon II. All these historical people would eventually lead and take over Israel. And Ahaz had a generous and gracious miracle being offered to him. Look back at verse 11 here in chapter 7. For the Lord spoke thus to me, this is to Isaiah, with a strong hand and instructed me that I should not walk in the way of this people, saying, say ye not, a confederacy of all those to whom the people shall say, a confederacy, neither shall ye bear fear them, nor be afraid. Dude, that was the wrong chapter. chapter 7. That verse 11. Sorry about that. Ask thee a sign of the Lord. Here's what the Lord's saying through Isaiah, Ahaz. Ask a sign of the Lord. Ask it either in the depth or in the height above. But Ahaz said, I won't accept it. I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. He's being offered an out by the Lord through Isaiah. These folks, these tribes above you, the Israelites above you, plus combined with the Assyrians are coming to attack you. I'll give you an offer. Here's a great offer for you, if you'll accept it. Ask a sign. He said, I won't even ask. I'm going to do this myself. In fact, he preferred to make an alliance with Assyria, this great giant empire that was going to eventually take over him and everybody else. Make an alliance with Assyria to ward off these other two tribes that were attacking him. God said in verse 14, well, I'll give you a sign in that case. You don't want a sign? You won't ask for a sign? Therefore, the Lord himself shall go ahead and give you this sign. What's the sign? That you'll have a son. There will be a son, a child being born to you. And Ahaz was intent on that alliance. Here's the sign. The immediate context. A son would come. Before that son was very old, if you read a little further here, a judgment would come to Israel and to all this region. The birth of this child. This child may have been Ahaz's child, but more likely he was Isaiah's child. We don't know who it was. His name was Maha Asher Hazabah. We read his name in verse 8, or chapter 8. This child who would come, this immediate context here, he would come, and before he got old, judgment would come upon Israel, which meant Assyria would come down and conquer them, wipe them out. Fulfilled son there at chapter 8, verse 1. The destruction of Ephraim and Israel, and later Assyria would come in there and take them over. But tucked away within this verse 14 is not just the near current fulfillment, because it is. There's a near fulfillment, a far fulfillment. Now, all prophecies were that way. And the near fulfillment was this son whose child would be born. Then that judgment would come. But there's also a distant prophecy, which no one fully realized. No one realized this until the New Testament writers explained this verse, that this would be a fulfillment of someone even greater than Isaiah's child or Ahaz's child and the judgment that they would face. This son would be born and be named Emmanuel, which simply means, as we know, God with us. Literally, with us, God. It's only used three times here, and then in chapter 8, and verse 8, I believe, and then in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, where it's explained. Literally, with us, God. And it would take on a totally different meaning when the New Testament writers look back at this beautiful verse. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. Well, Jesus' name wasn't Emmanuel, but the concept was there, God in him, in us, God with us, excuse me, and he would set us free. I want us to see in this passage here four truths that surface about his coming. This Emmanuel who would come and set us free, provide this hope for us, even today. Now those folks would look forward to a hope. We look back upon it and realize it's already been given. This child, number one, this child would have an unusual entry into the world. It doesn't say that, but the word sign is there. A sign that a virgin would be with child. Again, a sign indicates a unique fulfillment of a prediction. Be very unique. It has to do with the time of Ahaz that day. It also has something to do with far future, 700 years in the future, when Jesus would be born. A child would be born. It's interesting that Ahaz, this king, had a son named Hezekiah. Hezekiah was a good king. But yet Hezekiah, because he disobeyed God, God was going to bring judgment upon him, and then Hezekiah begged the Lord. He fasted and prayed, and God said, okay, maybe I'll give you a 15-year extension, and you'll have a son too. In Isaiah 38 and verses 7 and 8, God would give him a sign, and that sign would be the sundial. The shadow on that sundial would go back 10 degrees. And that fulfilled. So God's always in the place of giving signs or indications of the future. But in this case, a virgin will give birth. I mean, it's an unusual thing. Now, folks who read the Hebrew at the time thought, that's no big deal, a virgin give birth. Because the word for virgin there is alma, a word which means a young maiden. A young maiden of marriageable age. Probably a late teenager, and that an alma. But then in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, it speaks about a virgin, and uses a Greek term, parthenos, which means an absolute virgin. It's never just a marriageable age young girl, because she could have had relations with a man and not be married. But Parthenos was always an absolute virgin who has never been with a man. And Matthew uses that term. Didn't leave any room for us to say, oh, well, that just means a young girl. No, it is an absolute virgin without knowledge of a man. One Old Testament scholar said the sign was on the one hand a mystery, glaring in the most threatening manner upon the house of David, which was at that time, it was like a warning to them. On the other hand, a mystery, smiling with rich connection upon the prophet and all believers, that those who hardened themselves might not understand, and they didn't, but that believers might increasingly long to comprehend its meaning. And when we look at this verse, we do. We look at how can we draw such powerful things coming out of this verse? That virgin, that unmarried and man, without relation to a man, having a child. And that's what it says. It's interesting that Peter wrote in one of his epistles, of this salvation the prophets have inquired and searched carefully, who prophesied of the grace that would come to you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ was in them was indicating. In other words, Those readers of Isaiah's writings in the time wondered, what does that mean? Does that just mean Maher, I can't say his name, long-term name? Is that who it's talking about? No. There's something greater than that. And those folks, even the angels, wondered, what does that mean? What does that come to be? God fulfilled it. So we have a very unusual entry into the world. A virgin birth. A baby being born and not having an earthly father. Then the second thing, the second truth that springs forth is that the offspring would be God incarnate. That means in the flesh. God would be a human being. This didn't apply to the present political corruption of King Ahaz, obviously, in those ancient times. But it spoke about a future king, a God with us king. He would be with us. And when we read the New Testament, we realize all those prophecies and the fulfillment in Jesus Christ, because all the New Testament writers talked about Jesus as God. How do you have a man who is God? Nobody believed that God could be a man. And yet John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. No one has seen God at any time. You can't see God. The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, He has declared Him. For a Jewish person, and those writers were Jews, to say that about a man being God was unbelievable. Romans 9:6, of whom are the fathers and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, the eternally blessed God. Calling a man God? That's what he was. Titus chapter 2. Looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. How could he be a man and yet God? 2 Peter 1:1, by the righteousness of our God and Savior. 1 John 5:20, we may know Him who is true, and we are in Him who is true, and His Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. That would be blasphemous to a Jew to call a man God. Luke 1:35, the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. 1 Timothy 3:16, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. Spiritual corruption in the time of ancient Israel, yes. But there was actually spiritual corruption in the future day, in the Colossian church. And with you, hold your hand here in Isaiah, turn to the New Testament, to Colossians chapter 1 and verse 19. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, chapter 1. For it pleased the Father, Colossians 1:19, for it pleased the Father that in Him, that is in Jesus, should all fullness dwell. For in Him dwelleth all the fullness. Chapter 2, verse 9. For in Him, that of course is Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. The corruption in Colossians was a theological error. It was what's called Gnosticism. This idea that we can worship angels, we can deny ourselves certain things. The body was evil, your flesh was evil. Only thing spiritual is the good stuff, things up above. And this idea in the Colossian church was receiving this Gnostic teaching that there were somehow emanations from God. And if you just connect into those emanations, you'll have the fullness, the pleroma. So Paul used the same word here. A complex mystical religion. And all these strange things was trying to find its way into Colossae. The Colossians were listening to that nonsense. And believing it. Kind of like some of the things going on today of atheism, as if it's a religion. It's not a religion because they don't believe in God. But they have all the rights of a religious group in our country. Isn't that interesting? And here's a group of folks trying to infiltrate and trying to make God's people worship stuff instead of worshiping God. And so Paul refutes this thinking by referring to Jesus as the true pleroma. The fullness is found in Him. And as you look here at first, or Colossians 1:19, after a litany of qualities of Christ, he gives a whole listing of the firstborn of God, the image of God, the Creator, the head of the church, the firstborn of the dead. And then he describes as all is the true fulfillment dwelling in Him. He says, don't be fooled by this deception. Don't be fooled by this falsehood. In Christ is the fullness, the pleroma of God dwells in Him in bodily form. Now, what does that say to us? It says to us that Jesus is God as a man, the God-man. How do we understand that? The fullness of God dwelling in Christ in bodily form. And it's not just indwelling as the Spirit of God. Now, God dwells in us. The Holy Spirit indwells us. But what we have in Christ is the theological term is hypostasis. It's a word which means understanding, standing under, foundation of who Jesus is, the very substance of who Jesus is, described by this fullness. For centuries, people asked, how could a man be God? This is the early church. How could God be a man? What is the essence of this God-man? And this concept of hypo, which means to be under and to stand under, to have this foundation, denotes the real personal substance of Christ. He is a man, He's God, combined in one person, not two persons, one person. How do we understand this dual nature of Christ? He's fully God, yet fully man. How do we understand it? The answer is we never will. Because we're not divine. We don't have all the knowledge of an infinite God. We never will understand it because Jesus is a unique person in all of history. He is one person. He's not divided into two different people. But He has two distinct natures. The early church tried to resolve this conflict because there were a lot of error, a lot of conflict, a lot of false teaching going around who Christ was. The early church had at least four councils, get-together groups of the leaders of the church, one in Nicaea, which said that the substance of Christ was the same with the Father. Constantinople, Ephesus, they had all these meetings, and the fourth one was in Chalcedon in Asia Minor in 551. And from a scriptural standpoint, Christ was there as had a union of two natures, a divine nature, a human nature. That's what we call the incarnation. Incarnation means in flesh. The human nature was inseparable from the divine nature. He is united forever with His divine nature in the one person of Jesus Christ. Yet these two natures remain distinct, complete, and unchanged, so that the person of Jesus Christ is truly God and truly man. You say, well, that's a lot of stuff to hear about, but there's a lot of errors going on in those days. That council met to resolve the conflicts of two heresies, Nestorianism, that said that God only indwelt Jesus, just like God indwells us, which is a falsehood. That He was not the real God-man. Eutychianism, which was another heresy at the time, they confused the two natures of Christ, bringing them together and set out the divine nature, the God side of it, enveloped or swallowed up the man nature, bringing forth neither a fully human nor a fully divine Christ. Now you say, what's all the importance of all this? In those ancient errors and how the church came together to come up with the truth, the conflict going on in those early centuries resulted in something we call Islam today. You realize that Islam came out of the conflict because Muhammad saw the conflict in the early church with these different thinkings. It's always just a bunch of baloney. We'll form our own religion and make it one God. The Council of Chalcedon, a remarkable statement came forth, is this. This is Christ. He is one Christ existing in two natures without mixture, without division, without separation, the diversity of the natures not being destroyed by their union in the one person, but the peculiar properties of each nature being preserved, concurring in one person. In other words, we don't divide the person of Christ, and we don't confound or confuse the two natures. And we remember that when we see Christ, the person of Christ is not divisible. He's not a two-part unit. You remember when he said in John 17, he prayed and said, "Heavenly Father, glorify me with glory which I had before the world was." He didn't say, "Father, glorify the God side of me as what we had." No, it's I, one person. In Mark 11, he said to disciples for a colt. In verses 12 and 13 of Mark 11, it says, Jesus became hungry. God doesn't become hungry. The man, Jesus, became hungry. In Acts chapter 20, Paul spoke to the Ephesian church. He said, "Shepherd the church of God, which he, that is Christ, purchased with his own blood." God doesn't have blood, but Jesus does. You don't divide Christ. The God side, the human side, is one person. Two distinct and inseparable natures, God and man combined in one. And we need to understand that. That's the incarnation. That is the fact that God incarnate has come to us. So he has an unusual entry called the virgin birth. He has God in the flesh, God, the very person of God. But a third truth that comes out of this Isaiah 14. You can turn back if you want. Isaiah 14. This coming person would manifest the presence of God. Now, obviously, we know that. Looking back. But they didn't. Emmanuel meant God with us. How can that be? God is holy. The holiness of God is true throughout Scripture. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Habakkuk says, "You were of purer eyes, Lord, than to behold evil, and cannot look on wickedness." God is holy. And yet it says he would be with us. With man in his sinfulness? There is none righteous, no, not one. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But in reality, it should have said, "God against us," because he should have been. Emmanuel? No, God against us. God opposes us for our sins because we are sinners. But it said, no, God with us. The presence of God would be in Christ. Fourth and final truth comes this. Emmanuel would fulfill all the Old Testament expectations of this Messiah. All would be fulfilled in Jesus. And by the way, I remember as Israel back in April, it was such a joyous trip. But one thing we learned when we talked about a local school group that was, I think it was a group of girls that were studying their scripture. Of course, they're Jewish, and they were studying the Bible, the Old Testament. They studied all the expectations that Messiah would have, and they went through all these expectations. They finally came to the conclusion that Jesus fulfilled every one of them. In Jesus. Now, they don't believe in Jesus, but they realize, hey, he fulfilled every expectation that they have as Messiah. They still look forward to a Messiah, but they're not looking at Jesus. The names of God. There are 42 names of Jehovah with a combination name beside. For instance, Jehovah Jireh means the Lord will provide. Jehovah Goel, the Lord my Redeemer. Jehovah Elion, the Lord Most High. Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of Hosts. Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is peace. All those combinations are throughout Scripture. The last one in Ezekiel is Jehovah Shammah, the Lord who is there. Emmanuel, the one who is with us, is that very same Jehovah in him. He's always there. He is with us. He's never going to leave us. Jesus said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." He said, "Lo, I'm with you always." He said, "He who comes to me, I'll have no wise cast out. If a man love me, he will keep my words," he said. "My Father will love him. and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. Not only is Jesus with us in the sense he is fully God and fully man, but when he enters our life, he comes into us. He relieves us of our sin and forgives us of our sin. And he'll always stay with us. He'll never leave us. The final words from God's throne in Revelation 21. I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their from beginning to end." This one who would come would be with us. Now sometimes when you expect things, your expectations kind of go lacking. We don't quite get what we want. Not quite fulfilled the way we had hoped for, but in Jesus, he was all that we could ever hope for. All, but that every expectation of God is in Jesus Christ. He offers himself to every one of us. Like the Christmas hymn says, "O Holy Child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today." We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. "O come to us, abide with us. Our Lord, Emmanuel, O little town of Bethlehem." Beautiful song. But he's the one who abides with us. Our Lord, who came for us, died for us, ascended for us, and offers himself to us and to you to be your Savior today. What do you need to do? Turn from your sinful ways. Turn from that sinful life. Ask him alone, the Savior, to come into your heart and life. And he will. He will be with us. Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the fact that the Old Testament prophet Isaiah saw these things, didn't maybe even recognize what they meant. But that the God with us who would come, this child who would be born, would be that. And we thank you that we can receive him now. He's grown, he's been to Calvary, done all the work that was needed to save us and to forgive us of sin. And now he's offering himself to you and to me. If we'll simply receive him, he will also come to be with us, to be in your life by asking him to save you. Turn from sin right now and ask Christ alone, the quietness of your own prayer life, "Lord, come into my heart and life. Save me. Make me a new person. I want Christ to enter in. To do the work that only he can do." As you're asking him, not thanking, he answers prayer that he will fulfill everything he says to us. Every promise of the Old Testament will be fulfilled. Every promise of the New Testament will be fulfilled in him and us. Thank you, Lord. Help us now to make public that which we have privately done in our hearts. Give our hearts and lives to Jesus, for in his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Our invitation hymn is number 275. "So I Surrender All." As you sing the words, let be your prayer for the Lord. I'll meet you right here at the front. You need to respond to him, giving your heart to him. Follow him in believer's baptism, the first step of obedience after receiving Christ. Perhaps you need a church home and God's been leading you here. This is where God says to come. You respond as well. As we sing number 275, let's all stand together.